Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I am Momita, moderator for the conference call. Welcome to Q1 FY22 results conference call of Oil India Limited, hosted by Antique Stock Broking. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star and then zero on your touch-tone telephone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I would now like to hand over the floor to Mr. Varatharajan Sivasankaran. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thank you, Momita. Good morning, everyone. I would like to extend a very warm welcome to the senior management of Oil India, represented by Mr. Harish Madhav, Director of Finance, Mr. P.K. Goswami, Director of Operations, and all the participants listening in the current quarter call. I would request Mr. Harish Madhav to give a brief, and then we can move on to Q&A. Mr. Harish Madhav?
Yeah, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I will request, I think the results we have already circulated to all the analysts yesterday, and they were hosted on the stock exchanges also. I will request my Executive Director of Finance, Mr. Sanjay Chaudhary, to give a brief, and then we can open up for the question and answer. Sanjay, please.
Thank you, sir. Good morning, dear friends. At the outset, I would like to thank Antique Broking Limited for arranging this call. We appreciate the interest shown by the analysts in the company. The financial results of Q1 2021-22 have been shared with all the analysts and posted on the website as well. I hope all of you have received the same. I would briefly give some indications about the performance of the company in both physical and financial terms. To start with, at the group level, income of oil for Q1 2021-22 is rupees 6,276 crores, vis-à-vis 4,334 crores in Q1 2021. The PBT in Q1 2021-22 is 1,678 crores against 526 crores in Q1 2021. The profit after tax at the group level of the company for Q1 2021 is 1,215 crores, vis-à-vis 378 crores in Q1 2021. Now, coming to the standalone results, and we'll begin on the production front. The crude oil production for Q1 2021 has marginally reduced 2.7 as compared to 0.752 MT during the corresponding quarter last year. However, looking at it sequentially from Q4 of 2021, there has been an increase of 4.32%. In case of natural gas also, the production in Q1 2021-22 has increased to 711 MMSCM as compared to 682 MMSCM. However, sequentially, it has increased by 9.52% from Q4 of 2021. On the financial side, the company's profit after tax in Q1 2021 has increased by 1,056 crores, from loss of 248 crores in Q1 2021 to profit of 507.94 crores in Q1 2021-22. EBITDA during the similar period has increased by 295% to 1,296.92 crores due to better price realization. EPS has increased to rupees 4.68 per share in Q1 2021 as compared to -2.29 in Q1 2021. The crude oil price realization has increased to $67.15 per barrel from $30.42 per barrel in the corresponding quarter last year. The increase in price has led to an increase in turnover by rupees 1,350 crores and PAT by 675 crores during first quarter of 2021-22. The average natural gas price realization in the first quarter was $1.79 MMBtu as compared to $2.39 MMBtu in the corresponding quarter last year. The decrease in price has led to decrease in turnover by 111 crores and profitability, that is profit after tax, by 75 crores during the first quarter. The low realization of natural gas has been a matter of concern since last year. In the current quarter, oil has taken provision of well write-off against wells to the tune of rupees 6.22 crores, which is against 268 crores, which was in the first quarter of last year. We have Numaligar being our material subsidiary. We would like to share some of the financial information relating to Numaligar. The performance after tax of NRL in Q1 21-22 is 678 crores against 423 crores in the corresponding quarter last year. NRL's GRM has improved to $5.21 per barrel in Q1 21-22 from negative $3.15 per barrel in Q1 of last year, and EPS to 9.22 per share from rupees 5.75 per share in Q1 of the previous year. We are also happy to inform that in the country's fight against COVID, the company is supporting the cause by providing PSA oxygen plants, oxygen concentrators, and cylinders to various states. Additionally, the company has created a 100-bed COVID care center and is undertaking widespread vaccination program in its operational areas, covering all stakeholders. In order to encourage excellence in sports, the company has decided to honor Ms. Lovlina Borgohai and Ms. Sakum Mirabai Sanu with a cash award of rupees 25 lakhs each for their outstanding performance in individual events in the Tokyo Olympics. With this opening remark on the performance of the company, it's over to you and we are open to the Q&A session.
Thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question and answer session. If you have a question, please press star and one on your telephone keypad and wait for your turn to ask the question. If you would like to withdraw your request, you may do so by pressing star and one again. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. Ladies and gentlemen, if you have any questions, please press star and one on your telephone keypad. So our first question comes from Mr. Somaya V from Spark Capital. Please go ahead, sir.
Hi, sir. Thanks for the opportunity. So my first question, can you please share the NRL numbers, what you gave for this quarter vis-a-vis the last year quarter? Can you please provide the numbers for the last quarter, as in 4Q21, the GRM and PAT numbers if possible?
Last quarter GRM. Last quarter GRM.
So may I have last quarter GRM readily, I think it's not available. We can send you an email or maybe separately communicate that. You want Q4 GRM?
Yeah.
We'll communicate. Maybe during the call itself, we can communicate. Just give us some time.
Sure, sir. And also, this quarter, including excise duty benefit, what would be the numbers?
Can you speak, please, louder?
Yeah. This quarter, including excise duty benefit, what would be the GRM number?
The excise duty benefit, I think that is something very, very specific to the Northeast refineries. So we feel that it will not be a comparable number if we are comparing the GRM or the performance of the refineries, which is reflected in the GRM with the other refineries. And moreover, we do not have that number ready because NRL also doesn't disclose that number anywhere. So maybe we can, if it is a specific request, we will have to collect it from NRL and then come back to you.
Okay. Sir, and can you just provide an update on the CAPEX program, both from standalone operations perspective as well as NRL perspective?
From standalone perspective, this year our program CAPEX plan is around 4,100 crore. Last year we had done about 4,600 crore total investment plus 8,600 crore plus in NRL investment. This year CAPEX plan for oil is 4,100. NRL, since it is just commencing on the refinery expansion plan this year, plus the biorefinery project, I think it is in the range of about 1,000 crore for 21-22.
Okay, sir. And for FY23 in NRL, because of this expansion program, just wanted to get an understanding of that.
FY24 NRL capex will be certainly much, much higher, because this refinery expansion will be going ahead. Only thing is that since the capex for the new refinery or expanded capacity was initially 22,000 crore, which is now under approval for 28,000 crore. So specific numbers may be available after some time when the revised numbers are approved by the government. So maybe in the next call or 1 or 2 months later, we will be able to share those numbers, the exact spread of that capital allocation.
Got it, sir. And just on your volume outlook, production outlook, both in terms of oil and gas, you've been giving this. So both for this year as well as in the next 2-3 years, your medium-term outlook, keeping in context of your new project that's coming in.
In fact, we have a growth plan of production for the next few years, up to 23, 24, 24, 25, and up to 24, 25, 26 also we have a growth plan. And we are targeting a very aspirational target, but the things are, we are working on that. Once everything is finalized, then probably we'll be able to give the exact numbers.
Sir, your debt and cash numbers at end of this quarter, sir?
Cash is very minimal now. It's maybe a few hundred, 300-400 crores only, not much. But we have the tax-free bonds of about 1,500 crores, and the cash and mutual fund investments of about 400-odd crores, and debt is close to 9,000 crores, standalone. One sec, I'll just confirm the debt number.
Only debt too. Debt.
About 11,000.
Got it, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Participants are requested to restrict with 2 questions per person during the initial rounds. Thank you. The next question comes from Mr. Prabal Sen from Centrum Broking. Please go ahead, sir.
Thank you for the opportunity. Good morning, sir. So with respect to the production outlook, I got the point that, you're working on a longer term range. I had a specific question on the Baghjan field. You had mentioned last quarter after all the, fire related activities have now been completed. And prior to the incident, I believe this was one of the more promising regions in terms of, exploration outlook and production growth that we had. Just wanted to understand now, where do we stand in terms of development or exploration activity on this asset? And do we still believe that this can add, if I believe the number shared a couple of years ago was that this field and this asset alone can add 3 to 4 MMSCMD of gas production. Is that accurate or, just wanted to get your sense?
Yeah, thank you for the question. You're right. Basically, in Baghjan, everything related to fire is now closed. And we have been working on that field right now, and the production from the field is to the extent possible now, the maximum production we are getting from that field only. And most of the, we have already started working on three rigs. That means we are working on 3 drilling operations in that site, and 4 workover units are also placed in that area. So the exploration and production activity is going on at full swing in that place, and as you have rightly said, we earlier declared that this is one of the most promising fields, and the with the support from the present ministry also from in the state of Assam, we have been working in this field very nicely. There is no disturbance as of now, and the production figure from this field is going up from day to day. So we are very hopeful that this field will be giving the most promising results in the days to come.
Is it possible to share what is the production level now, sir, and what do you expect it to be maybe by the end of the year or next year?
For the entire field, or you are asking about the Baghjan field particularly?
You know, the Baghjan area, basically, I believe there are a number of smaller fields as well, I mean, in that asset, in that block.
Exactly, giving the figure for Baghjan, that is not readily available with me right now. So I'll have to find it out. Maybe during the course of this discussion, we can find it out for the Baghjan field separately.
Trouble, you want the production of gas from Baghjan field separately?
Yeah, I just wanted to, sir, get a sense that, you know, what is the recovery looking like? Because we had mentioned that this will be a primary driver for gas production growth for us before the incident happened. So that's the sense that I just wanted to get, sir. That's all.
Still, this is continuing. This is the most promising field, and we have been working on that. In fact, we are working for infrastructure facility development in that area, which will be capable of handling 5 million gas. So we are targeting 5 million gas. So that is on the hand, the infrastructure development project is also going on. But if you ask me the exactly what is the today's production, that I cannot be, I may not be able to give you right now. But our target is 5 million from that area.
One more thing is there, Baghjan.
Yes, sir.
See, that one particular well which was producing around 80,000 MMSCMD per day, that well, which basically the blowout where it happened, so that well is closed.
Okay.
I would say that presently the production, though maybe from the other wells we would have increased a little bit, then unless a new well or something is drilled there to start to augment the further production, the production from that particular field will be more or less static. Yeah. As of now.
Yeah,
but certainly
okay.
We have that augmented development plan for that Baghjan field. And in that plan, very soon we will be starting production and all those things. There are certain issues, so things are getting resolved.
No, one thing I just like to add, one well was complete yesterday.
Okay.
So we have started producing from that well yesterday. So the location TBK is producing from yesterday. So we have been getting that gas from that.
So one production has direct operation, it says one well has come up, new well has come up in production effective yesterday only.
Got it. So basically, sir, over the next few years, we would expect to see a gradual production uptake from this area, right?
Yes,
exactly.
Yeah. Great, sir. Sir, second question, if I may, on the 280 billion of revised capex for NRL, you said it is still in the process of finalization, but roughly, the funding of this will be in the 30-70 ratio. So 30% will be an additional equity contribution from Oil India?
No, that increases the capital cost from 22,000 to 28,000 crores. As of now, it is supposed to be funded 70% through debt and 30% through equity. But the equity, there will not be any additional contribution as per the anticipation. NRS internal resources will be sufficient to fund that additional 30% equity of 6,000 crore investment. So from the partners, shareholders, the equity contribution which was there at 22,000 crore investment level, the same level is anticipated as of now.
And the timeline would be basically about 3 to 4 years, sir, for completion of this project from the time of final approval?
Yes. Project is already, work has already started on the project. So by 24-25, the refinery expanded capacity should get commissioned.
Got it, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for the detailed answer. I'll come back if I have more questions.
Thank you, sir. The next question comes from Mr. Abhishek Datta from Prabhudas Liladhar. Please go ahead, sir.
Hello, sir. Sir, just carrying on from the previous question, if you plan to ramp it up gas volumes to buy 5 MMSMD, does the region has a demand potential of that amount currently, or how do we plan to, export the same or what?
No, gas exports from India is not at all permitted. Oil, crude oil and natural gas exports in any case is not permitted. The demand is also coming up, and our production ramp up also will be in line with the demand ramp up which is coming up. The BVFCL, they are coming up in Namrup 4 fertilizer plant. There is some more power plant also, capacity is under getting increased. Assam Petrochemicals Limited also is going to increase its capacity. So apparently the demand will also increase over the next 2 to 3 years period, and our production growth also will be in line with that demand projection.
Sir, in your presentation, you have mentioned that this expected production of 5 MMSMD can happen by FY24. Is it a realistic target, or it can be delayed also, sir?
It should not get delayed. All efforts are being made to stick to that production target. We have made commitments,
sir,
to the industry and all of it.
And when you say NRL expansion will complete by FY24-25, you mean FY24-25 or...
Yes,
FY24-25. Okay, sir. And sir, so, yeah, that like last year, FY21, what was the dividend which you received from Russia?
Russia dividend declaration is on calendar year basis. In fact, the first dividend we received from our subsidiary in Russia, about 230 crores dividend, that is All India International Pte. Limited, which is our wholly owned subsidiary, that declared a dividend of about 230 crores, which All India received from Singapore. But total dividend received from Russia last year, I will just give you the number.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, sir. So we have the next question from Sabri Hazarika from MK Global. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good morning, sir, and congratulations on good numbers. So I have two questions and followed by a bookkeeping question. So the first question is, how much crude Oil India is selling to NRL currently?
About 60% of our crude oil production goes to NRL. Say about out of the total approximate 3 million, 1.7 million ton goes to another.
Okay, and it is like a totally arm's length transaction, right? There is no no synergies as such in
no,
this
it's
transaction.
It's absolutely on arm's length basis, on the same pricing structure on which we sell to other refineries.
Okay, so there is no specific synergies regarding NRL being a Oil India subsidiary now. Okay,
so,
and
there are certain limitations also with the related party transaction. We have to have transaction on arm's length basis. Otherwise, it requires AGM shareholders approval, board approval, and all those things. So, normal course, the business with the subsidiaries also has to have be on the arm's length basis, and even on the taxation perspective also. If we have a differential pricing or something, it will attract transfer pricing issues, etc. So, for business, it has to be on the arm's length.
Allocation is the center only.
And the crude oil allocation, in any case, is done by the Petroleum Ministry.
Okay, sir. Fair enough. Second question relates to status of this panel regarding gas pricing reforms. So, I know that gas prices have gone up in the last few months. And probably in the next 1 year, it may be higher than what was actually asked by the companies. But still, is there any update on that panel regarding gas pricing reforms?
Yeah, that panel had submitted its report in December itself. But so far, somehow, it is still in the ministry under process. So nothing concrete has come out of that report. Though one or two meetings also have happened, but... I think it has not yet moved to the cabinet level. So there is a status quo as far as the pricing structure is concerned.
Okay, sir. And the bookkeeping question, I just wanted to reconfirm again. So you said that your standalone debt is around 9,000 crore as on June end. That's right?
No, I think that number was not right. 11,400, I corrected that. 11,400 was a long-term debt. And as of 30th June, the additional short-term debt which we had taken for NRL funding, 2,350 crores. So total debt, if you take, it is long-term plus short-term, it's about 14,000 crores. But out of 2,350, 400 crores we have repaid already post 30th June. So current debt is 11,400 plus say around 2,950, so about 13,500.
And this is standalone debt.
Expect to liquidate another about 1,200 crores within next 15 to 20 days.
Q1.
Okay, and this is standalone you are talking about, right?
Standalone, yes.
Okay, and you said your cash is around 400 crore, and you mentioned also about short-term investment. What was it? I couldn't get
short-term
that.
Investment for the long-term investment in the tax-free bond. We have about 1,400 crores tax-free bonds.
1,400 crore tax-free bonds and 400 crore of cash.
Okay. Yes.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much. And all the best.
Somebody asked question about the Q4 GRM of NRL. It was $11.63 per barrel.
Thank you, sir. So we have the next question from Mr. Nitin Tiwari from Yes Securities. Please go ahead, sir.
Good morning, sir. Thanks for the opportunity. My first question is with respect to your operating expenses in this quarter. So there was a sharp decline vis-a-vis the March quarter, especially in the contract cost. So what is this related to, sir, if you can just throw some light on that?
The increase in the contract cost is basically on account of a higher exploration activities, survey activities in the new OLP blocks that we have received.
No, so I think there is a decline in contract cost, right, vis-a-vis March. So what is that? What does that decline pertain to? And also other expenses are down. So
That is what I'm saying. In March quarter, there was an increase due to the OLP exploration survey cost.
Okay.
That showed the higher contract cost in the last quarter last year, which is was more than the average cost of contract that we normally have.
All right. So, sir, the contract cost that we've seen in this quarter would be a more ongoing run rate. Is that correct?
Right.
And, sir, my second question is related to your crude production. So, we've been, experiencing a decline, a continuous decline sort of in crude oil production. So what is the outlook in case of natural gas? You did highlight that we are looking to increase the production by about 5 MMSCMD over next couple of years. But what is the outlook on crude? If you can give us some sense over this. Or are you going to see? Yeah.
The production, if you compare to last quarter, Q4, it's sequentially increasing. But compared to last year, maybe as you were saying that there is a slight decrease in production. So slowly we are going up. From the last quarter, we have increased by around 4%. Then we have a plan to go up, and new things are coming up. New wells, as I said a few minutes back also, new wells have started giving production. So production is going up, and we are looking for, as it was committed to ministry also, that 5 oil plus OEG, 5 million at one point of time, 24-25. So we'll be able to achieve that. That is what we have now planned.
Sorry, I missed the MOU target that you spoke about.
Sorry, repeat again?
Yeah, I missed the MOU target that you spoke about, that you promised to the government. I missed that number.
No, MOU target is not yet finalized, it's still under discussion. Anyway, MOU target is something totally different what the company's actual performance can be. Because
right.
MOU is guided by certain other factors. Now, earlier MOU target and company's production target used to be more or less in sync. But now things are going in a different manner altogether. So MOU target is not at all comparable. Of course, MOU for 21-22 is still under discussion.
Right. No, my question was more on a longer term basis. Directionally in a long term basis, because at least if we look at the production 10 years back, it was about 3.5 million ton. Now we are looking at more like a 3 million ton, and there has been a continuous decline that has been happening over a period of time. So are we going to continue to see this decline in crude oil production, and because natural decay in the oil fields, or are we going to see a scenario where the production actually looks up? So that's what broader directional question is, what was there?
Yeah, in fact, there is always a decline in production because, as you have said, these are all basically matured fields, and matured fields has a tendency to decline the production every year. But at the same time, if you look at our reserve replacement ratio, we have been going always in a positive direction. It is always past more than one. So that indicates that we have been able to compensate that decline through the creation of new reserves and new production. So we are very hopeful. We have now started working very aggressively in some particular five fields. So those are basically compared to other fields, these are new fields. And we have an expectation that we will be getting a quantum jump in production in the coming days.
Okay.
Similar to forecast or the estimate what we gave for the natural gas production, we have a program for fast-track development of certain identified fields in mainly in Assam, Arunachal, and also in Rajasthan. So that should give us good production growth in crude oil as well. But the numbers are a little uncertain, so unless we firm up the plan, it will be difficult for us to quote any number, but maybe after some time we should be able to, once the program, everything is confirmed, then we'll be able to share some good numbers with you. But certainly there will be growth in crude oil production, and significant growth, what we mean.
Right. Lastly, sir, if I may push just one more, you also mentioned a purchase of gas as a small quantity. What is that related to? In your financial analysis, there is a small purchase of gas. So what is that related to actually?
Zero gas.
The purchase of gas?
Yeah.
Yeah, purchase. In fact, we have a joint venture block. It's a pre-NEP block with HOEC in Assam, Dirog. So,
okay.
India is having 44% stake in that block. The other partners are HOEC and Indian Oil Corporation. So, whatever production from that gas, that block around 1 MMSCMD currently. So, 44% entire gas. In fact, Oil India is marketing 100% of Dirog gas at present. But 44% of that, we show it as purchase of, 44% is accounted as our production, and balance 56% is shown as purchase of gas.
All right, understood. So 44% belongs to you, that becomes a part of your own production, and this 56% is what you market as a purchase gas.
Yeah, purchase, and then accounted for in sales also.
Got it. Understood, sir. Thank you.
And before we proceed, there was one question about the dividends received from this Russian company. As I mentioned, the Singapore and Russia, this is accounting is on calendar year basis. So in calendar year 2020, from this Bancor and TASC 2 assets, we received total dividend of about $393 million. And also in current year, 6 months, January to June, we have received a dividend of $96 million so far.
Thank you, sir. The next question from Mr. Vidyadhar Ginde from ICICI Securities. Please go ahead, sir. The next question from Mr. Vidyadhar Ginde from ICICI Securities.
Yeah, sorry. Good morning. My first question is, Numaligarh, do you have EBITDA for the first quarter?
Okay. We'll just take out the number and the mission. Vidyadhar, you can, if you have
Sure.
Closer,
yeah, the other question was that in case of Numaligarh, your stake, I think at the beginning of the quarter was slightly over 80%. And then I think you've sold about 3 percentage points to the Assam government. So two questions related to that. One, so how is your accounting in the first quarter? Is it pro rata part of the quarter at 80, balance at 77? And the next related question is, press reports were suggesting that the balance stake sale you will do to the Assam government by September, so that their stake goes up to 26, and I think yours will come down to around 69-70. So is that on track to happen in September?
Yeah, that is on track. It was only waiting for the budget sanction for the government of Assam. I think in this assembly session, the budget has already been presented. Once it is approved, we will get the money and the share transfer will happen. And that is expected to happen before September, certainly.
And what so about the
share will be 69 point something percent, close to 70%.
My first question was regarding, so how is it accounted in first quarter? Is it pro rata part of the quarter at 80 and your share of profit, and part at?
Those shares have been accounted for as assets held for sale, and are not been taken into the account in the share capital.
Oh, so basically, are you saying that your first quarter profit, you are only accounting what will be your eventual stake?
Yes, Yes.
Okay, so you are not accounting 80% of the profit or 77%. You are accounting that 69% of the profit.
Consolidation is done based on the stake as on 30th of June, so which is about 77%.
Okay, so it is done on that basis.
March we consolidated based on 80% holding.
Okay, okay. So it's based on actual holding.
Actual holding as on the date of the balance sheet.
Okay, okay. And last question, do you plan to have any gas production in the near future, in the next 1 or 2 years, where the development of the field is happening or something, where you will be entitled to deregulated gas pricing?
No. As of now, all production growth will come only from the nominated field.
Okay, but even in nominated, I think there was some provision that any FDP in Northeast after July 2018 or something would be entitled to deregulated pricing.
That's right, but provided there is any field discovery, we are not having any new field discovery.
So it's not an existing field, just field.
We'll be augmenting production.
Okay, okay, okay. So anything of this sort is some time away?
Yes, yes. Unless we get some discovery in OLP blocks or something in DSF blocks, then yes. This
but that will also take some time.
Certainly, 3 to 4 years minimum time.
Okay. Thank you.
And
that should
you asked about Vidyadhar, you asked about the EBITDA of NRL. In Q1, it was 986 crore.
Okay. And what is the same period last year? First quarter?
635.
Right. 635. Okay. Thank you very much. Thanks.
Thank you, sir. The next question from Mr. Vikas Jain from CLSA. Please go ahead, sir.
Hi, thanks for the opportunity. So I just wanted to ask for this quarter, is there any IOC dividend which is there? I mean, I think the second interim dividend should have come in this quarter. Is that the case? Or that's not something that they did happen last quarter itself?
Q1, no dividend.
No dividend. There's no big dividend which has come except in this
Q1
particular
quarter. Q1, there's no dividend. Of course, interim dividend nobody declares in Q1. And Q2 dividend also will be only the final dividends which have already been declared, which will be paid after the AGM. So that way.
Just wanted to check. So IOCL dividend, was there a big IOCL dividend in last quarter?
Last quarter, yes, it was. Q4.
The other thing is, in terms of the debt movement, could you just give me a sense on how would you, so currently you're saying that debt is about 14,500 crores, right, gross debt?
Yes.
About 2,000 crores is what you said, the cash and liquids, right?
11,400. Yeah, debt is about 14,000 crores, say 13,800 as of 30th June, which today it has come down to about 13,400 because 400 crores we have repaid. And the cash is cash plus investments put together is about 1,800 crores, 1,800.
Okay. And so how do you see this debt kind of moving by the end of the year? And what is your cost of debt? I just want to understand how debt will move. How should it? What will be the interest cost exit roughly for the last quarter?
Interest cost, I think we would have already mentioned.
No, I'm saying that how that would reduce. So broadly, how would debt reduce?
Okay.
Yeah.
See, the rupee debt we had taken from Numaligarh. Now, it was total 6,300 crore we had borrowed, 2,000 crore for long-term 3-year period, and 4,300 was short-term. Out of the 4,300 crore, as of date, 1,950 crore is already repaid. 2,350 crores, close to 1,200 crore, we expect to repay before September. So that will further reduce to around 700 crores only, because 1950 is remaining today. 1200 will be about 750 crores short-term loan only will remain after September, which also if the prices remain at the current level, even $65 average, we should be able to pay and
gas prices also improve, I think cash flows will improve in second half. So we should be able to liquidate the entire short-term loan by end of the year. So that will leave 2,000 crores for the long-term, which depending on the circumstances, availability of funds, we will try to liquidate if possible even before that. The rest of the loan is all this long-term loans for foreign currency borrowing, around 11,400 minus 2,9,400 crores. This is all overseas borrowing for Mozambique. So that loan will remain for some time. Earliest maturity is 2024.
And for this long-term debt that you borrowed from for NRL, what is the rough cost of debt for that?
That is 4.5%.
And that is rupee loan, rupee long-term loan.
It's a rupee loan, yes.
Okay, sir. That's it. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. The next question from Mr. Vineet Joshi from Goldman Sachs. Please go ahead, sir.
Hi, sir. Thanks for taking my question. I had a question on the gas production, that 5 MMSMD growth that you have projected by FY24. Can you give us a path in the sense that how much will it be over the next 1, 2, 3, and 4 years? And what is the capex that you're looking to spend on this growth? And finally, I think somebody else asked this as well. Like, what would be the end demand sectors consuming this gas growth, you know, because the growth is quite substantial. Thank you.
We are working on that figure, that year-wise production. But as of now, our production from this entire Northeast is around 7 million. And from a particular field, we have been looking for a production of up to 5 million that you are mentioning. So in that field, presently, we have a production of 1.6 to varies between 1.6 to 1.8. So that is the present production trend right now. So end of this year, we'll be going to 2 and slowly we'll be going to 5 by next 3 years. That is the working plan we have been working. And accordingly, we have been placing our drilling rigs for that. And drilling activities are going on, as I have said, few minutes back. Yesterday we have started producing one new well, and which is giving a good result now. 0.2 million we are expecting. As of now, it's 0.1 plus. So within a day or two, the entire flow will be established. Expecting that. So this is the plan as of now. And regarding the market, so maybe the Madhav Sahib has already explained that the entire gas production is now being sold in the Northeast only, partly to Numaligarh Refinery, partly mostly to BCPL, Brahmaputra Crackers and Polymers Limited. And there are some fertilizer plants in Namrup and power generation in Namrup. So in Government of Assam is planning for one more additional plant in that power generation unit. So that will give another requirement, and as of now we have been we are also in touch with those for market. So there is no dearth of market in the Northeast for gas production.
And what would be the capex for this growth, sir, overall?
On this particular project of this field gathering station, it's around 400 crores project, 300 plus crores project, but procurements are going on. Once the all procurements are finalized, the exact value will be finalized. But the presently we are targeting a capex of around 400 crores.
So, Vineet, this what Director of Operations just now mentioned about the project. This is in respect of one capacity for the take care of the increased gas production. Now, for production growth, certain additional wells and all those things also will happen. And that will get covered. It will be difficult to say that this will be gas well. This is because it's all common capex for the oil and gas well infrastructure. So total capex, what I mentioned, current year about 4,100 crores. Future years also, it will be between this to 4,500 crores on an annual basis. That will take care of all this infrastructure development,
including the wells.
Yes, okay. Including the wells, the facilities, everything.
And what is the reserve potential of this field, sir? I mean, just trying to get a sense that for how long will you be able to sustain this production in the future? So if any color you can provide on that, that will be helpful.
It's very difficult to give an exact number, but we can give you assurance that this field will produce for not less than next 40-50 years.
Okay. Thank you, sir. And so one last question. I mean, we're generally seeing this trend where a lot of the, you know, E&P producers are now investing in renewables. So can you just update if you have any such plan in the future to invest into the green capex?
The renewables?
Yes.
No concrete plan as such, but yes, we are in the process of having some thought process. We certainly have to augment renewable capacity, solar, and something in biofuels, a lot of things we are discussing. But as of date, there is nothing concrete to share with anybody. In fact, within the company also, nothing concrete. So maybe 1 year's time, if something concrete comes up, so we'll be able to tell something. But as of now, nothing.
Okay. And maybe if I can just ask one more question, sir. I think the slight increase in CAPEX at NRL that you mentioned, so can you update us, like, what is there has been any change in terms of the growth of the capacity or the, you know, the upgrade that you're looking to do at NRL? If you can update us, what exactly is the plan with this slightly higher CAPEX?
Enhanced capacity will be from 3 million to 9 million ton only. Only thing is, this additional CAPEX increase from 22,000 crores approved to 28,000 crore proposed is basically towards this making the refinery production petrochemical ready. It is not that the petrochemical plant will be established, but the production and all will be what we can say it will be ready raw material for petrochemical plants subsequently, which the refinery may think of. So this additional CAPEX will be towards making the refinery ready for petrochemical production, production of raw materials for the petrochemicals. So that's how it is being done.
Okay. Thanks a lot for your time, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. The next question from Mr. Manikant Gare from Axis Capital. Please go ahead, sir.
Yeah, good morning, sir. Thanks for providing me the opportunity and congratulations on good set of numbers. So if I look at your gas production, the quarter-on-quarter improvement has been to the tune of 0.6 MMSMD. So is it fair to assume that the incremental 0.6 MMSMD would have come from Baghjan field itself?
No, it's a combined growth, not only Baghjan.
So which are the other fields which are supporting this production growth here?
Our gas production is coming mostly from greater Habzan area, we say, in our terms. But it's you can say our earlier fields of Naharkotia and all those fields also are contributing to gas production. In fact, there is a substantial amount of gas production from our whole Naharkotia field.
Okay, so something is being done there to get incremental production because we have not seen such contribution earlier from these fields?
Yes, yes. Regularly, all those old wells, we do workover operations. For workover operations also, we get some additional production. These are old wells, not new wells.
Right, sir. And my second question is with respect to, you know, when Harish Madhav sir was mentioning about the consolidated CAPEX for FY22, he mentioned about a biorefinery. Can you please provide some color on that? What is the CAPEX and what is the concept about? How much is the capacity and timelines here?
I don't have much details on that, but Numaligarh refinery is in collaboration with some foreign partners, is setting up a biorefinery, ethanol plant basically. So that is a bamboo-based ethanol production facility which will be coming up in the close to Numaligarh only. It will produce ethanol from bamboo. So generation, basically you can say a pilot sort of plant, first plant in India to produce from this type of products, bamboo. So that is the thing, but not much details are available with me at the moment readily. But subsequently, if required, we can share the exact details.
the conceptually is this, and the refinery is also likely to come up in next 2 to 3 years' time. I think it should start producing.
Sure, sir. So just wanted to get clarification on one thing. So this ethanol refinery predominantly produces only ethanol, or because it's a biorefinery, will be able to?
Supposed to produce ethanol from bamboo. And then ethanol will mix up with the petrol as per the government's ethanol vetting program.
Right, sir. Okay. And any CapEx number that can be provided or capacity?
Readily, I don't have. I think that information we will need to take from another and then share with you.
Sure, sir. No worries. So, if I understand it correctly, apart from the 4,100 crores of capex for a standalone, what would be the console level capex? So if you can repeat that.
Console level will be anywhere between 5,000 to 5,500 for current year, including another.
Sure, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. The next question from Mr. Gagan Dixit from Elara Capital. Please go ahead, sir.
This gas consumption by the Numaligarh refinery at present, and is there any gas consumption increase by the NRL by the increase in the capacity?
Yes, yes. There will be increase in gas production also. Currently, we have contract to supply 1 MMSCMD, against which, depending on their requirement, on an average, we are supplying around 0.7 MMSCMD to another. And the enhanced capacity also from 9 to 9 million will require some additional gas.
Okay. Okay. So why I'm asking this, sir, that because in the past we have seen that your many of the gas reserves are under the contingent resources because of the limitation of. So, if with the increase in the NRL demand, so can we expect that something increase in the or upgradation of the reserves from the contingent resources to the proved and probable reserve? That is, can be the possibility, sir?
In fact, there is a plan for increasing for gas production in our old fields. So, the plan is already there. So, with the increase in demand from the field, definitely we'll be able to cater for the demand.
Okay. Yeah, that's the mic. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, that was the last question for the call. I would now like to hand over the floor to Mr. Vardharajan Shivashankaran for closing comments.
Thank you, Mamita. I would like to thank the senior management of Oil India, Mr. Harish Madhav, Mr. P.K. Goswami, Mr. Sanjay Chaudhary, and all the participants for taking time out for participating in this call. Have a nice day. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you
for arranging this call. Thank you so much. And thank you all the
participants. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of Antique Stock Broking, this concludes your conference for today. Thank you for your participation and for using Door Sabha's conference call service. You may all disconnect your lines now. Thank you and have a good day, everyone.